Welcome to the Sweep Spot mini episode 30. And for these mini episodes, I've been trying to have more guests on that we can squeeze in our tight schedule. And I've really been enjoying doing these, and I've been doing these alone mostly, and it enables me to be able to schedule them easier. And I kind of like the format with a one-on-one conversation sometimes. And so for this episode, we're going to welcome back someone that we've had on our show before and who has become a friend, and that is Robyn. How do you say your name? White shades. Yeah.
Robyn Service. Are you looking at the shots part?
Yeah.
Throwing you off? Yeah, that's my maiden name.
Right.
Service. Yeah.
Okay. Well, welcome back, Robyn.
Yeah, calling me a friend. We have kind of gotten to know each other pretty well since we did the podcast last year, and it's cool for me because I love seeing you and talking to you online too, even though you live far away.
So we were able, like I said, we were able to talk to you. We talked about a variety of things, I think, last time you were on, and found out that you were a big Country Bear Jamboree fan as well as I am, and that was fun. But I wanted to talk more about the ambassador program, since they just selected the ambassadors for 2022-23.
Yes.
And you were able to be there for that.
Yes, I was. Yeah. Very lucky. What a great morning.
Yeah, I watched the video and it looked really exciting.
It was really exciting, and there was like a giveaway for tickets to be able to attend, because it had to be sort of distanced, but right. Two members were given tickets to attend, so it was cool. It was really it was intimate but big at the same time, and very exciting.
Do they usually do it in the Fantasyland Theater?
No, not usually. Uh-huh. I'm not sure there is a usually anymore. I think we're kind of in a transition. So yeah. The second time it's been held at the Fantasyland Theater. First time was in for the Millennial team, and that's the only ceremony I've actually ever missed. I was working on a cruise ship at the time, but it used to be in front of the castle. It's been in front of the train station. It's been over at California Adventure. So it's been in lots of different places, but this year was Fantasyland Theater, and I thought it was a great venue.
Yeah, that is. And you know, it's outdoors, but it's covered, so that's nice. I couldn't remember. I think they did one year when I was working there. They had done it in front of the train station, and then I saw it, of course, in front of the castle other times.
Yeah, the train station is fun. The only thing that worried me and all of us about the train station is they had us all walk down the cement stairs.
Oh,
and
no.
I thought for sure somebody was going to eat it down those stairs, but they didn't. None of us fell, so it was great.
Oh, good.
Cement walking, that's a lot of big stairs, and they're all cement, so.
Right. Well, even just walking across the stage, you have that moment, and you're like, all right, don't trip, don't.
Stairs to get down off the Fantasyland Theater stage, too, and I just thought, if go down, it's going to be me, for sure, because I'm a big klutz, but I managed to keep it together.
Wow. Well, wanted to rewind a little bit and remind everyone about your career at Disney and when it started. And you hired in what year was it?
I hired in 1992, tour guide into guest relations, and stayed there for several years. And then I went into the Disneyland Resort Leadership Development Program. So I became a manager in Center Stage, which used to be called Center Stage. It was Main Street Attractions, Guest Relations, Main Entrance, and Parking. And kind of split apart to the main entrance. And then I was an area tour representative for a while in 1995, when I got to do part of the Disney University, the second part of the day with new cast members, giving them tours of their area. And then in 97, I was selected to be part of the resort ambassador team. So that's the year that I served as ambassador, 1997.
Wow. So quite the career there.
It's kind of like a dream come true, and every time I talk about it, I still get goosebumps, because really I could not have asked for a better trajectory or path, or you know, just time. Yeah. I think in my life was pretty amazing.
It really is. And even back then, changed a little bit, but I remember becoming a cast member my first stint was in 91, 93. I was there at the Plaza Inn, and mm-hmm. I remember it was a hard to get in back then, I think. Actually, I didn't get selected the first time I went in for an interview. And then I went back again when they allowed you. I think it was 6 or 8 months or something. And then I went back, and then I was selected again. But
And that was
yeah.
custodial bus plaza in. Is that
true? Yeah.
Same with me. I applied in 1991, and I wasn't selected for the role that I was looking for, and I came back and applied the next year. I definitely think that was sort of a thing at the time. I mean, we had fewer roles in general, right? Because the resort was so much.
That's true. Yeah. And so we're gonna kind of. We talked a lot about the time when you were a tour guide, but we didn't talk a whole lot about the ambassador program and the selection process and all that. And at the time that you applied, where were you working at?
At the time that I applied, I was a manager at the main entrance. So I was working with Dave O'Mell and Kim Sims, Dean Yamada, and a team at the main entrance, and I was part of the management team there. And it was the third time that I had applied for the program. So, in fact, most of the ambassadors applied more than once and then, you know, ended up as part of the program. I feel like it's one of those things where the universe knows when and where you're supposed to be in the right spot, you know?
Right.
So I had applied three times.
So when you applied, I mean, was it just, because I don't know any of this, so I'm just asking, you know, but...
Kind of want me to go through like kind of what the process was.
Yeah, like did you just go pick up an application and hand it in, or I mean, how did that work?
I was selected. They hold kind of informational sessions, and you get to find out more about the role, more about the expectations, and just to sort of know, you know, what the program is looking for with regard to, you know, your personality and those types of things. I mean, spoiler alert, they just want you to be yourself, so that's what they want to know about your personality is who you are, right?
Right.
But, we picked up an application, and it was, I'm assuming it's online now because it's, you know, not the 90s anymore, but an application from the Disney University offices and the old admin building there, and applied. And then, you know, just the basic requirements for applying for the program. And now there are actually more. The ambassadors hold what's called Ambassador 101, which is several interesting and informational classes, not only about the role, but about the resort and the company. So cast members get a really good sort of deep dive into the focus of the program and the history of the program too, because the program started in 1965. So we have a great legacy of ambassadors, not only at this resort, but around the world. And so now and at the time, so in the 90s, the process included as a semifinalist, you know, helping out, volunteering at events in the park, working with the Disney Volunteers program directly. So, you know, community events and just watching how you interact. And there's a lot more of that now, which I think is great. So the finalists get to interact with cast members around the resort, as well as the Disney Volunteer Program, which is the, you know, the cast member volunteering program. And so they get the opportunity to see, you know, where the, like, the heart of the cast members and where their passions lie, and, you know, how we spend our free time too, not just what we do at the resort, but how we spend our free time. And so the new ambassadors this year, they went through quite the process, a really stringent process. And And they're amazing. All five of the finalists seemed great, and it was lovely to meet them all, and we're excited for Mark and Natalie. It's going to be cool.
So after you put in your application, and so they take those, and then they select, I mean, I don't, you may have not know how many they select to be interviewed.
So I know that they interview every eligible cast member. So like I said, they go look at your attendance and, you know, that type of thing. So if you're eligible to be the ambassador, you do get a first interview, which I think is great. I mean, I think that gives every cast member who wants and is eligible, you know, the opportunity to put their best foot forward and, you know, see how they come off in an interview. And it's a panel interview. So there are cast members from lots of different departments, and they interview you, and it's like five of them and one of you. So it's a little intimidating, but yeah, so everybody who applies who is eligible for the role gets to interview.
Okay. And then is there just one interview before they select the final?
So at the time, there were not the finalists, but the semifinalists. So it kind of gets whittled down over the course of several weeks. And now I know that process even started in July. So with the Ambassador 101 classes, started even earlier, but there's a semifinal process and then a finalist process. And the finalists are ultimately decided upon by executives from the departments that you'll be working with most closely. So public affairs, community events, the volunteer program, you know, that type of thing. So all those departments get together and discuss what the needs are and who they think will best fit that need.
Wow. So is the president of Disneyland at that time at any of the interviews?
Yes. So the president of Disneyland was in the finalists interviews. At the time that I was a finalist, we had 10 finalists. This year and in recent years, they've whittled it down to 5. But yes, the president was involved. In 1995, Jack Lindquist still was kind of in and out at the park, not working at the park full time, but we got to meet him as part of that process. And he's the executive who, you know, he's like a big, you guys know, he's a big, and I have several pictures with him, and I can't even believe my luck that I got to know him, as part of that process. Him and Dick Nunes and, I don't know if you remember Hideo Amamiya from the Disneyland Hotel back in the day, but just these amazing people who had so much history with the park and the resort and, you know, just direct ties to Walt Disney. And it was a huge honor to get to know them. So the president is involved. The vice presidents are involved. And then they ultimately decide and then they hold the ceremony. And the ceremony is a really special moment. And I'm glad that there was a time when I think it was just part of the process that the ambassadors were sort of announced like over a Zoom call. And there was like a real small, you know, meeting in a boardroom kind of thing. And I was thrilled to see this year. Actually, Justin and Rafa, too, they did in the ballroom at the Disneyland Hotel or at the Grand Californian Hotel. And it was really fun and ceremonious. So this was cool to get back to a time when, you know, we could all kind of gather and welcome, because it's a special legacy to be a part of. And, you know, we want the new ambassadors to feel welcomed into the, into the ambassador family.
Yeah, I was going to say, just sort of a family that's
right.
Not a huge family either. So
it's not, but it's cool. It's like it's its own little family, but we're also part of the bigger Disneyland Resort family. So we have, you know, we all come from different, very different backgrounds. I mean, from foods to merch to entertainment to guest relations to everywhere. And so, you know, it's such a widespread group, and the support from the cast members is so huge. So yeah, it's pretty cool to be a part of that.
So when you were selected to be a finalist, how many at that time, how many was it?
There were 10 of us total.
10. Okay.
And the first time I was selected as a finalist was for the first ambassador team that was ever created, because it used to be one individual, and then the team was created in 95. So I was a finalist for that team, and I was not selected for the first team. And then I applied the following year, and I was not selected as a finalist at all. And then the following year, I was selected both as a finalist and for the ambassador team for that year.
So you never give up, right?
No. You know what? I wanted that role so badly that when I was 12, I was watching the Hollywood Christmas Parade. I may have told you guys the story before. I know it's just me and you, but I keep saying you guys because I know Ken
is fine.
I saw the Hollywood Christmas Parade, and the ambassador and Mickey were in the parade, and I thought to myself, and I even said to my mom, I was like, that's my job, that's what I want to do. I didn't even know anything about it. I was just like, I just want to be with Mickey Mouse in a parade. That's the job I can ever imagine doing. And so it never occurred to me that I wouldn't get it. But of course there's a huge chance you're not going to get it. I mean, look at the numbers of people who apply, and the talent in the cast at the Disneyland Resort it's through the roof. So of course there's a huge chance you're not going to get it, but I think it just never occurred to me. It's something I wanted so badly, and I got really, really lucky, really lucky.
So you were picked to be a finalist for for the 97.
So for the 95 team, I was a finalist, and then I was selected for the team for the 97 team. So it was late 96. It was actually on my sister's birthday, November 20th. I remember that she was there at the ceremony and jumping up and down. I can see her in the video, and it makes me so happy because it was cool to see my whole family there. But it was on my little sister's birthday that year, so November 20th, 96. Yeah, well, I'll never forget.
Let's talk about that, because as I was watching the video, I had a lot of things I was thinking about. I thought, so you had no idea that you were going to be chosen, right? No.
And as a matter of fact, it, you know, that last few seconds of the ceremony when they announce your names goes so fast, right? But I had, as I said, been a finalist before, so I had been standing in front of the castle, you know, just so excited, just couldn't believe it. I don't know, like hubris or what, thinking like, this is totally my role, this is it. And I wasn't selected, so I've been there before, right? So it was a very humbling experience, and also it really put into my head, like, this is not, there is no guarantee about this. This is anybody's game. These are talented, wonderful people. So it might not be you. Like, the second time I was up there, I was like, it might not be you. Just settle down, you know, try to remember that this is just an honor to be here. And the first two teams included a man on the team, which was wonderful. It was the first time that it happened at the Disneyland Resort. So we had men on both the 95 and 96 teams. And we had 5 men and 5 women as finalists for the 97 team. And so I guess just assuming in my head that one of the people selected for the team would be a man. Yeah. And when the president, who was Paul Pressler at the time, he said, this year we've selected 3 ambassadors. And I thought, okay, 3 people, right? At least one is going to be a man. At least one. Maybe more. At least one. And they announced the ambassadors, and they announced this in alphabetical order. And the order went Christina McGeorge, Kathy Milam, and Robyn Schatz. And the split second in between Kathy's name and hearing my own name was like, well, that's it. It's going to be a man is going to be the third person. It's just the way it's going to be. And so when I heard my name, it took me a couple seconds to realize what had happened. And it's just, I mean, it's a moment that I'll never, ever forget. But it's funny watching the video because I think my sister was up and out of her seat before it even registered on my face, because I was like putting on the happy face, right? I was putting on the, it's okay, everything's fine, this is fine. And because you work so closely with the finalists together for so many events, you love them all. You don't want to see anybody not be selected, right? So I was genuinely excited for whoever it was, and also disappointed for myself. And then all of a sudden I realized that it was me, and it was a pretty breathtaking moment. Pretty cool.
Wow. I can't imagine. I mean, so the ceremony happened, and what did they do after that day? Like, did you just go home? I mean, did they
So that changes year to year. However, what we did that year was we all the finalists, and then Kathy, Christina, and I, after doing just a couple like quick interviews, and we did like a caravan on Main Street with the fire engine. They had like a banner that they put on the fire engine, and we got to ride and do a little caravan. But then we all had lunch in Aladdin's Oasis, which you probably remember Aladdin's Oasis, but it's where the Terrace used to be, and then it became Aladdin's Oasis, and now it's Tropical Hideaway with delicious Dole Whip. So good. So we all went to lunch, and it was really nice. And I will say that that was kind of a change that happened that year, because in previous years there were all different things. Sometimes everybody went to Club 33, and sometimes you got a meal voucher and went to the Plaza Inn, and you were kind of there with your family. And I think from the experience of having been through as a finalist and not having been selected, Kathy and I both had been through that process the same year, actually. And, you know, we talked with the program about it and just kind of gave the feedback that it's a hard time. If you really, you know, you apply and it's a lot of emotions, and if you're not selected, it's kind of hard to just be out in public in the park, and a lot of people are coming up to you, and it's a little overwhelming. So we decided to do a private lunch, you know, and it was nice, and it was a moment where we kind of all got to, you know, celebrate together without having to put on, you know, a happy face if it was disappointing, because anytime you want something in life and it doesn't turn out the way you want, it's disappointing, right? If you're not disappointed, maybe you didn't want it at all, right? So
right.
So we had lunch in Aladdin's Oasis, and we got to have the little chocolate lamps, and those were amazing.
Oh yeah.
Yes, chocolate lamps filled with chocolate mousse.
Ooh.
So good. Yeah, I know. Now I won't. Yeah, they're so good.
Wow. So, you know, what a day. I mean, you probably didn't sleep the night before. I mean,
I think I didn't sleep the whole week before, because we had so many interesting and like interactive events to do. We did like a community event. We did a volunteer event. We, you know, I was just so just kind of overwhelmed by the enormity of the impact that Disney has, right? It's mm-hmm. such an impactful brand in so many people's lives. And so the weight of that is not lost on, I think, you know, the ambassadors. It's something that you kind of carry with you, and all the cast members at the resort, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, everybody, they find out you work at Disneyland, and it's a big deal. Even now, you know, you put that on your resume, and it's a conversation starter, and it's a very well-respected brand, and for customer service and otherwise. So
yeah, I think that for interviews that I've done after Disneyland, and I've done many for the job that I have just for promotions, but it always kind of steers away from the actual interview when they start asking me questions about Disneyland and,
right,
you know, it's pretty funny.
Yeah, it is. Yeah. And it's just kind of neat to see, you know, the impact that it carries around the world. So, no, you're right. I mean, I have, you know, up until very recently, I'd been gone from the company for 23 years and I still kept it on my resume for that reason, because it is a conversation starter. And it also speaks to the training, right, that we get as cast members. It speaks to our customer service, our problem solving, I mean, all kinds of things. And so it's definitely a bonus, a feather in the cap to have when interviewing for any job.
Yeah, for sure.
Yep.
Well, great. And I know we could probably talk more and more about the time that you spent doing that, and but maybe we'll continue that and save it for another time.
Sure.
I
talk to you anytime, Lynn.
Yeah, well, I appreciate it. But we'll definitely come back to this and we'll talk some more about it. But I appreciate you coming on.
It's my pleasure. Thank you.